Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the stage from the 118th ASOS North Carolina Air National Guard, AFA's National Director, East Area, Major Tyler Johnson.
All right, good afternoon, and thank you again. Before I introduce our next panel, I did want to let you know about one of AFA's STEM programs called Stellar Explorers. Stellar Explorers is a challenging high school space system design competition that involves all aspects of system development and operation with a spacecraft and payload focus. It's actually quite impressive. So tomorrow I would encourage you in the Conway room, just down the hall. Students will be demonstrating the program between 9:45 and 11:45 a.m. So I encourage you to stop by and check it out. But back to the main event. The topic of our next and final session today is U.S. Air Force current operations. As you know, the Air Force has been in continuous combat operations for nearly 30 years, with total force airmen leading the charge for the last three decades. Today, the Air Force and Space Force are engaged in operations in air, space, and cyber with peer adversaries. Today, our panel will discuss current operations, ops tempos, and how our airmen are able to combat enemies who are becoming increasingly more sophisticated, both in their weapon systems and their ability to engage and challenge our airmen around the world. Our panel includes Lieutenant General Richard Scobee, Chief, Air Force Reserve. You can give a clap.
Thank you very much.
Major General Kevin Huyck, Director of Operations, Headquarters Air Combat Command. And lastly, Major General Kirk Pierce, Air National Guard Deputy Director. Again, copies of their bios are in your program. I'll now turn it back over to AFA's President, Orville Wright, to kick off the panel, moderate the Q&A. General Wright, back to you, sir.
Thanks, Tyler. And thanks again to Tyler for his volunteer leadership. And again, he's one of our relatively new directors on our AFA Board of Directors, and the promise for the future of our Air Force Association. So let's start, open up the panel today, and we'll start from right to left. General Scobee, staying with our overall theme of all that our airmen are doing around the world, our total force airmen, reserve, guard, and certainly active. So thanks, sir, for being here, and please go ahead.
Hi, thanks, General Wright. I really appreciate being here. Thanks for the invitation. You are very hard to say no to. And thanks to the audience for being here. You know, if you think the 4 o'clock section is not so great, try to be the pre-barbecue, you know, session. So this is even more difficult. I'm really proud to be here and proud to represent the 74,000 folks that are in the Air Force Reserve, and that is in all statuses, including our great civilians. And I tell you, it is really good to be here at AFA. This is where we feel so connected to the airmen and everything that goes on. And I have to tell you, for the last 3 weeks, I've spent all my time with Congress talking with our appropriators. And of my 7 combat deployments, the most dangerous one I've ever had was being in the District of Columbia. So this is far better. When you look at the Air Force Reserve, our goal is to provide our citizen airmen to the joint force in whatever capability that's needed, but it's to fly, fight, and win in every domain. And that's what we've been able to do since 1947. One of the things that's really neat is that providing the daily operations, about 6,000 to 7,000 airmen in the Air Force Reserve are mobilized every day, not continuously, but continuously across the year. 6,000 to 7,000 of them are mobilized. And that is just to do downrange and recurring operations for our Air Force, which is pretty impressive. So it's almost 10% of us are mobilized at any given time. And the command chief and I, we have 3 main lines of effort that we're trying to get through in our time here in the seat. The first one is making sure that our readiness is where the United States Air Force needs us to be. And so we spend a lot of time ensuring that that capability is resonant in everything we do. With that is our strategic depth as well. So with the operations tempo that we have on a recurring basis, and what's neat about being the Air Force Reserve Commander is you work with all the other major commands in helping them to provide forces as well. But what we want to make sure is we keep that strategic depth. And so the operational tempo is something that we work on every day, and it's not going to go away. And we're trying to right-size our force and give our airmen the right pay statuses that they need to be in order to perform the jobs that the American people require us to do. But if we don't keep that surge capability when a big war or something flares up, we'll lose the ability to surge along with our other reserve component, which is the Guard, to meet that challenge. And it's something that's very important and we have to be able to do. And then the next thing is building resilient leaders. And I'm talking about leaders at every aspect, whether you're an airman leading yourself running around, or even our commanders, colonels, and even generals. We have to have resilient leaders that the Air Force can use and plug and play in whatever capacity that they're going to need. And so we really work on making sure that we educate and train our airmen in order to be that. But it's resiliency, and it's not just the airmen. And Secretary Barrett said it great today. It is also the families as well. So we're really focused on what are we doing that's going to take care of our airmen, because without them, readiness goes away, and there's nothing that we can do in our current operations. And that is the strain that is on everything from a day-to-day and our day-to-day operations. What is really neat about the reserves is it doesn't matter whether you're doing special ops to ISR, whether it's space operations to flying combat fighters, whether it's doing cyber operations to what we're doing with our mobility air forces. Every single mission set that the Air Force does, the Air Force Reserve is in, from missile silos all the way to flying satellites. So it runs the gambit. And what we have to make sure is, are we in the right places where the Air Force needs us? Because our mantra in the Air Force Reserve Command that the Command Chief and I talk about all the time is, hey, we produce combat power for America the best that we can at the least burden to our taxpayers, because we're that value approach to defense that we have in order to afford what our country needs for our Air Force to be able to do. And we concentrate on all that with our other two components. And I think there is no Air Force in the world that does a better job than what we do as a three-component Air Force, which is fantastic. So with all of that ops tempo and building those resilient leaders, how are you going to do that, and what does that full-time force need to look at? Look like? And that's what we're really focused on in that second line. And the last one is reforming our organization. One of the things that Tim White, my command chief, and I constantly are struggling to make sure that we do is that we provide that environment where our airmen feel valued and they feel connected, because valued and connected airmen are what are going to produce that combat power that we need. So we're really focused on that. And I'd just like to wind up with saying, before my counterparts get a chance to talk, I'm looking forward to your questions, because there's nothing that I am more passionate about than what we do in the Air Force, and in particular what we contribute as the Air Force Reserve, because that's what we're trying to do, produce combat power for America. Thanks for everybody being here today.
Thanks, sir. General Huyck.
Thanks, sir. So General Holmes had us all cut our hair. I thought about stealing his slides, but I chose better judgment. I tell you, walking around the symposium and talking to airmen, I couldn't be more proud to be sitting up here with my Guard and Reserve counterparts for this panel. I look forward to your questions. But just to remind you, we're really busy. I know the brochure said we're talking about current operations, but to get after the challenges that General Holmes laid out for what we're doing in Air Combat Command, it's real important to remember that it's not about the weapon system or the platform. It's about the airmen that are operating the platforms. And we heard the chief earlier give us the charge of putting an airman on the weapon system, putting an airman on the loop to share all of that data. And we know that the decision advantage is really what we're trying to get after. The use of the Uber, the Lyft app that you saw before. Remember, the Chinese or the Russians or our peer adversaries, they can get in there and they can start to manipulate that. So it's you, the airmen, those cadets in the back that I was talking to with the challenging questions, it's you that make everything work. And as we look at Air Combat Command, we really have three areas that I'd like to talk about. And the first one is force generation and force optimization. General Holmes kind of laid out the experimentation that our wings are doing. And we see every day where they're constantly tweaking and refining the tactics, techniques, and procedures of that optimization and that force presentation. And we know that there's not enough white space for every one of you. And I'm talking to the back 10 rows that are challenged with the operational tempo that we see on a daily basis. We mentioned the current deployments that we're on. And most importantly, we know you need to be home with your families, you need to continue to connect, and you need time to train. And that's really the second area is that training. We have a future training concept nested with the Headquarters Air Force operational test and training infrastructure that looks at giving you opportunities to get in the simulator, out on the range, and to fight against those peer threats in a training environment. So when you're at that red flag that the chief talked about, or you're at a virtual flag, it's not the first time that you'll see that when you get into combat. And then finally, there's been a lot of talk about our 16th Air Force and information warfare. And there's no doubt on a daily basis that we are in that information environment every day, and we're competing every day. And I'd like to say it on the stage here that, yes, we're at war in the information environment on a daily basis. And you airmen are the ones that are going to help us succeed and win. So look forward to your questions about that, and I'll hand it over to General Pierce.
Slide up.
You can go to the slide. So thank you very much. I'd really like to thank AFA. I'd like to thank these two exceptional officers that I've served with on active duty and while in the Guard. They're great officers to emulate. If you get to know them or you already do know them, you know that. From the Air National Guard perspective, thank you for industry to allow us another opportunity to sit down with you and talk about what our airmen need from grassroots up capability. What can we bring to the fight? Both from the Air National Guard, from the active duty, and from the reserve. You'll hear throughout this when I talk about the big blue. The big blue is all three components. All of us have to be healthy. If we're not all healthy, then we're not the team that we need and not what the taxpayers are paid for us to go out to compete, deter, defeat, and win a fight if ultimately it does come to that. So it's important for us. If you can go to the next slide real quick, just so that you can see. This is just a snapshot. Apparently, I didn't get the memo as the dumb GO of the two other ones that are here. Mm-hmm. So I have just two slides. And what I want to show there is a snapshot in time on the 20th of February. We ebb and flow between about 8 and 10% of the 107,700 airmen that are in the Air National Guard being deployed. When it says NORTHCOM, that's just in NORTHCOM AOR. So some of those missions that we do, RPA, DCGS, in a Title 10 status, also what we do in Title 32, whether that's supporting NORAD or global strike in an alert posture with tankers and fighters for NORAD, and where we convert automatically from Title 32 to Title 10. It's a seamless effort that goes across the Air National Guard to make sure that we're doing our part of what's been assigned to us as a mission for the Air Force. And then across the world in the other AORs from CENTCOM, SOUTHCOM, INDOPACOM, UCOM, and in AFRICOM, it's everything from agile combat support to very platform specific to what General Holmes talked about. We still are, you know, certain individuals doing key mission sets that we need, but trying to aggregate it around teams. So big picture, you're looking at about 8,000, you know, about 2,500 in the Title 32 status, about 2,500 in Title 10, and the rest of the different stuff. If you can go to the next slide. So you've heard the why, and I kind of do a why, what, how. The first bullet in sub-bullets is the why. You've known that. Just got done working at NORAD for General O'Shaughnessy, laying out why the homeland's no longer sanctuary, why we need to be able to project force from the homeland and be able to influence others either by deterrence by denial or deterrence by punishment. But at the end, we're an instrument to make others comply with the instruments of power that the United States can bring to bear. So the Air National Guard's part of that. I'll skip more to the important part is the what. So the Air National Guard's going to transition into the Air Force we need. We rely on working with the Air Force, working with the other MAGCOMs, and you telling us where you need to have manpower to mission. And we're ready to transition and do those things. All units have difficulties with stop starts. For the Air National Guard, a little bit of uniqueness in the Guard and Reserve that we're community-based. Yes, you join the Air Force, and yes, you may join the Air National Guard, but you join a unit in your state. So it's a little bit harder to move manpower across state lines. We don't have the same capability for that. But what that does bring to you is it brings you a capability, a capacity, and a diverse, experienced workforce that's either a civilian or an airman, whatever status. We can keep working on reform, but on the status reform, but whatever in status. And I'd like to thank anyone who's out there who's in the Air National Guard, Air Reserve, in the Reserve, or in the active component. Because the greatest compliment I get is you're downrange. I don't know if you're Guard, Reserve, or active component, because you do the JOB, and that's what we want to drive after. If you're at home and you're in garrison, only way I can tell is I came on your base and you don't have a BX, and apparently you don't have a golf course, and everything's inside the operational wire at an Air National Guard base, and
But when you get into the squadron, we organize, train, equip. And what kind of changes this in the National Guard, I also have the Army National Guard side that I deal a lot with. But we organize, train, and equip, and we evaluate to the same standards. There may be a longer timeline for some things because of our part-time force, but the regular Air Force, from the Inspector General down through the MAJCOMS, is very understanding of, we're going to have the same evaluation criteria, it just may take a little bit longer in the training period. What I'd like to talk a little bit more about is, we have the unique opportunity, and it's an opportunity, to work for three chiefs. So now we have General Raymond on the space side, where we have seven states and soon to be the territory in Guam doing the space mission. We have General Goldstein, who we work for on the in the Air Force side, and then we have General Langell on the National Guard Bureau side. So as we're working through those things, you know, what are we focused on? In our lines of effort, you've heard it before, you've heard the same echoes of it, it's what the Big Blue Air Force needs to be, a competent and reliable and trusted force. We're focused on readiness. If we can do AFWIC and we can look out into 2030 and we can do pacing units and look at everything that we want to do to be able to compete against peer and near-peer adversaries, but if we're not ready today and we aren't setting the seed corn for in the future to be ready, then what does that matter? You know, taxpayers paid for us to be ready to do what the President and Congress has asked us to do. Operational execution, that goes from mobilization authorities, everywhere from in the state where in the Air National Guard we do state active duty to support the governor. We do incidental training in 502F or in our Title 32 status to support the active component mission. And then we get mobilized to go downrange and whatever authority that goes there. And then force structure. Where is the force structure that we need to do for the Air Force we need and the Air National Guard we need? So when those stop starts are difficult for us because we are community-based, so how do we have a smooth transition from going from one platform or one mission set to another to ensure that we are ready and we're there to be interoperable, capable, and provide you the capacity and those diverse leaders, followers, and airmen to do the mission set when required? All of that, we're looking internally, and this is not your standard, hey, tick, new GO, you're gonna reorg. It's not reorganization of the staff, it's realigning the staff. We know that we need to develop into the 21st century. We're doing that, but where can we restructure? Where can we take some risk and push manpower and move some Title V civilians and move some of our active component headquarters staff, not in the states, territories, or in the district, but in the headquarters staff to help us enable to meet the demands and really get after some of those things that as an Air Force we need to do. We're very flat in the National Guard. We have a smaller staff than other places, but we'd like to box above our weight if we can. And then finally, it's already been touched upon by these two cats up here are way smarter than me, human capital stewardship. We have to not only recruit and retain, but we have to develop our airmen. And we want it to be so that you can be downrange or you can be in garrison. You don't know the difference between an Air National Guardsman, a reservist, or an active component member. We've been developed, we have the education, we have the ability to plug into the joint force, so we're not just this isolated cylinder of excellence that's the Air Force, that we can do those joint jobs and have credible airmen that go out and do that and are respected for what they do. And then after the fact, they go, oh, I didn't know you're from California. You know, where'd you grow up? What'd you do? Oh, are you in the Guard? No, I'm not in the Guard. I'm regular Air Force, or I'm in the Reserve. That's where our lines of effort are going. We think there's some advantages in the strength and alliance of partnerships. We have a state partnership program. If anybody wants to ask questions about that, to speed things up. And in the Guard, we also are very connected in the interagency, everything from the federal level, DHS, all the way down to the local level. If you're from Massachusetts, stay away from the stateies, but other than that, you'll be all right. And then enhanced performance and affordability. You know, where can we innovate? Where can we look at total force integration? We're meeting next week in DC to go over that and not just talk about policy and instruction, but where does the rubber meet the road that we can take best practices and make a difference for our airmen? And again, make Big Blue as healthy as it can be. My own personal opinion, ticks, is, you know, our total obligation authority is going to be challenged. So what does that mean in the back row? Because you don't speak TOA speak. I didn't do that when I was a captain. We're going to be at a certain level amount of money, and we have to be innovative. Yes, innovative with AI, machine learning, but we have to be innovative with the force that we have and optimize the force that we have. So we really want to have that budget discipline. So with that, I know General Holmes talked about it, and we're in the less than envious, it's like Catholic Church here, front rows aren't filled up. People getting ready to go for a barbecue and to interact. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak, and thank you very much.
Thanks, Tick. There's a, as always, you all haven't slowed down at all. There's lots of questions as we look forward to a cold one. This audience includes a very articulate set of advocates for our total force, for our total force airmen. We have AFA leadership. We have very senior leaders from industry and a cross-section, again, of our own total force audience that engages from the local city level to the state level to the DCAOR that General Scobee describes. So how do we together, and we'll start with General Scobee, could you give us some points on the why and the need for 386 squadrons?
I will take no hard questions. So what's the next one? No, I'm just kidding. I tell you the why and what we work together, and obviously 386 is across the entire Air Force, and it is about producing the combat capability that we really have to be able to produce in the total force. What that really means to us is how is that going to fit in, and what weapon systems or capabilities are we going to bring to bear? So when you look at the 386 squadrons that we're going to need to have in the Air Force, it's really about creating capabilities and effects you need, whether it's getting into JADC2 or if it's working in the legacy platforms that we've had and that we continue to modify as we go forward. So that's really what the 386 is all about, getting after the work that has to be done and what we need to be in the Air Force to be what the Joint Force needs us.
Joe Huyck.
It really comes down to my favorite topic, which is air power. Without 386, or even more as we continue to grow, that 386 affords us a training cycle where we can be deployed, we can reset, and get onto the training that I discussed earlier, and then get into a higher state of readiness where we're ready for tasking. And then if you're at an immediate readiness force, immediate response force, a contingency response force, your ability to respond to any challenge around the world that the commanders have laid out for us, the combat commanders and the theater commanders have said, I need you to rapidly deploy and be ready to rapidly employ. And to do that, you need to be in a training cycle. And this operational readiness training cycle, 386, allows us to generate that combat power, be there at speed, take it to the enemy in the domain that it needs to be, that we need to deliver the effects, and then quickly come back and reset, whether it's CONUS or back into assigned forces into the theaters, and continue that cycle again. And it's that readiness training cycle that our combatant commanders demand, and our theater commanders and the CFAC need, and 386 will do it.
Joe Pierce, would you add on that?
I'd say you all eloquently answered that. The only thing I would ask is mass is a quality, and there is the number I don't think is as important as what is the capability and the capacity that the taxpayers are paid for. And General Goldfein has been pretty direct on what does he think we need. Whether that is bounded by what we can afford, that's something for someone else to determine. However, that capability and capacity is what we really need to do. To piggyback a little bit on what you talk about, you know, in the Air National Guard, we look at not only like REGAF does for deploy to dwell, we look at our mobility to dwell, but AMC is really good about this to look at what are the other things that you're doing that don't necessarily count into you're mobilized, you're going down range, whether it's voluntary or involuntary. And they look at coronet missions, and they look at all those other things. So if we don't have that capacity and capability, a perfect instance for that is in the tanker fleet for us right now. You know, the Air National Guard tanker fleet's operating at an AMC commander dwell that's a significantly high level that we're putting constantly down range with an 8 PMAI, soon to be a 7 PMAI, 1 BAI unit. That's a challenge to continue that up. It's one of those things as we try to work through that, it gets back to the total number of squadrons. What do you need and what have you been asked to do? And the Air Force has laid out the 386 number, but really just trying to define what's the mass capability, you know, what's the mass and capacity that we need to get there.
Great. And from Senior Airman Fulton, and this is for anyone who would like to take the questions, thank you, Airman Fulton, for asking this question. With increasing numbers of enlistees having bachelor's degrees or higher, do you all see problems with retention expected, and are you prepared for the challenge of the draw, the retention issues that might cause?
A really great question. There's a story that's told about an airman that pulls up to the squadron and goes in and sits down at the keyboard or the weapon system, one of our many cyber weapon systems, and achieves effects in the information domain. And, you know, General Holmes says, and I like to echo it because I tell every airman that's there, there's no place else that you can do that legally and achieve the effects against our enemy. We're under attack every day in the information domain, and that's what we offer, that value of service, because you're doing homeland defense, you're supporting those airmen and those troops downrange, you're supporting delivering air power through your weapon system, and it's the only place that you can do that. Now, there are opportunities in the Guard and the Reserves as well, and in fact, one of the great stories, and I'll just steal your story, Tick, is, you know, that airman that pulls up to the squadrons in a very nice Beamer or a Jaguar, and he's in a Tesla now, and he's a vice president of, you know, one of the divisions for one of the major contractors, and that just shows you that your value of service, and we're in the uniform, and you can't tell which one of us is in which component, because we're all after the same thing, and that's delivering those effects and that combat power, and that's why everyone in the back to the front row wants to stay in, because that's what we're here for.
I want to echo that, because that's a great answer. The other thing is I think it's our responsibilities as leaders within our Air Force to ensure that we create an environment where all our airmen can contribute, and they feel that the contributions they make are valued by the organization, for them and their families. And so we have never before in the history of our Air Force have we had a force that is more educated and steeped in capability than we do in this in the generations that we are now have in the Air Force. So it's really incumbent upon our leadership to ensure that we understand the education of our airmen and that we're able to put that to use. And that's what I tell everybody when they come in, or I give a newcomer's brief, is, hey, come in, take a look at the organization, and then we need your help, because nobody is going to do this on their own. So these incredibly intelligent young airmen that you bring in, regardless whether they're non-commissioned officers or commissioned officers, they have a lot to bring to your organization. And what they should look at is, what jobs do they think they can do in order to make us the most effective Air Force we can be? And we need to get them in those jobs. And we need to enable them to change AFSCs or whatever it is, pay statuses, anything, in order to be more effective, because the old way of doing business is not going to work for us. We need to challenge our young airmen to be all that they can be for us.
Thanks. Anything to add? Okay, next question. No kidding, this is from Cadet Nino Balducci. If the tempo of F-15E deployments continue at the current pace, how will this affect the future Strike Eagle deployment cycle and the CAF as a whole? And obviously, I think that's for General Huyck. So.
I mentioned that white space earlier, but the second part of that is, and a really brilliant question, is the average age of our fleet is up there in the high 20s, almost approaching 30 years in some cases, and that creates a strain. But what I will say is, and I know there's some industry here, providing unique advantages with our industrial base, and the conversation we're having is, how do we modernize? And when the Secretary talked to us, she was very clear about modernizing our Air Force. There will be impacts. We have seen impacts, but it's through that innovative process that we look at. My neighbor is Tom Miller, the A4, and he talks about the predictive type of maintenance, and it's amazing what our airmen can do when you put a weapon system in their hands, and when they have good technical orders, and they're able to innovate and figure out whether it's 3D printing a part or writing a new algorithm that's going to tell them what pieces they need to work on in the weapon system. So it's the innovation of the airmen, understanding what the weapon system's telling you, and then continuing to work with the industry partners that we've seen here to figure out how we keep that fleet going until we can continue to modernize.
Thanks. This is from the 20th Fighter Wing, Tech Sergeant Robinson, Adam Robinson. What does the future hold for deploying C2 nodes more so as a team, as most of them are currently aligned under the mission support group and support a 24/7, 365 stateside mission? So, challenging question possibly, or a lot of good answers.
I'll start with a quick answer. Yeah, I'm in the center seat's always good. When we talk about command and control, that's just one of the many elements of employing that combat air power. And I'll give you a quick vignette in Air Combat Command. We changed our Det 4 into the 700th Air Support Squadron. And with the Air Support Squadron, they manage and work the Falconer weapon system for the AOC. And really to the point is not necessarily moving command and control teams and weapon system. It's where that data resides and how you have access to it. And we've been challenged by the combat commanders, as I've said, and with an Air Combat Command. We're looking at how we develop those teams and train them on a daily basis within the exercises and use the Shadow Op Center to develop those apps and figure out how we can quickly get into that DevOps cycle to share the information around the battle space. So no matter where you go, you should have access to the information, and whether it's on a handheld, a desktop, or you're connected into another weapon system, you're able to get that data and share that data. But the most important part is how we're gonna do that in training. Whether it's a mobile communications kit or when we talk about continuity of operations, whatever site you go and plug into, you're able to quickly open your app and access that information. And that's really the beauty of that joint all-domain command and control. When you can get the data, you can apply it, and then you can get whether it's a two-day ATO cycle or a follow-on command and control node, you're able to share that information and be effective.
Let's start with General Pierce, and really for all three of you. We have in our Air Force Association, we define airmen with a capital A as officer, enlisted, and civilian. So could you take just a minute and talk about the importance of your civilian airmen up to GS-12, GS-11, that range?
Yes, so, it's relatively easy for me to talk about. When I say airman, when I was a wing commander, and to this day, when I say airman, I try to say, look, I'm not talking about just someone in a uniform. Our Title V civilians are an important part for us. We have to have them. They're the continuity. The guys up here, where we came up through, when you're on the staff and you're working that at a headquarters, you're going to cycle through, you're going to bring expertise, you're going to be the one that's all fired up and you got all the great ideas. But the continuity that we use with those GS-12s, GS-13s, I mean, all the way down to some of our GS-6 and GS-7s, whether it's at a SPO on the headquarters, in some of our air traffic control squadrons in the Air National Guard, they're the continuity plus just some of the expertise. It's that diversity that brings to it. And I also talk about it because a lot of people look at it and they see the civilian side, the workforce, and they go, oh, you're just somebody who came out of a bag or out of a suit or came out of the military and came over to the GS. We're trying to ensure that we cultivate our GS, our Title V civilians, to be same development stuff that we talked about on recruit, retain, and develop, and educate. And how do we ensure that they have those experiences? General Kelly, I see him in the crowd from A1. They do a very good job of setting those things out and affording people the opportunity to go to school. We do the same thing, and we piggyback on that in the Air National Guard. Without them, we can't do our job. We cannot maintain and try to develop the readiness that we want to have. For example, right now, and when I talk about realigning, you know, we went back in, looked across our staff, and did a one-to-n list of every GS position that's in the Air National Guard headquarters staff, not in the states, in the territories, or in the district, and said, where are we going to align manpower to mission? So we pulled the GS, recategorized, and now it's going, and we're putting out a GS-14 position. It's out there if anybody wants to apply for it, as a mobilization in the Air National Guard. So that's the person that's going to run the OPT that runs across our whole Air National Guard headquarters and mobilizes from in garrison to security forces going downrange to fighter pilots to whatever you need for boss eye. And why do we go to a civilian? For that exact reason, that they're going to be the continuity, and we hire the right person and continue to try to develop those people, that we could hire them inside. We could hire them inside the DAF, you know, the Department of the Air Force, or we'll go outside to do that. But without that, you know, we have a really sharp captain or a really sharp colonel that does it, and it's personality-based. So how can we ensure that we realign, use our GS, develop them, and they're part of the team and they're critical? A little bit unique on the Air National Guard side also is we have Title 32 dual status technicians that are both airmen and have a civilian that's tied to their military role. And they go out and they'll be wearing a uniform and working on it, whether it's in the Total Force Association, where General Huyck was the wing commander before, and they're out working on the line. So we do the same thing working through WG, WS, and those lower GS. It doesn't matter where your scale is, it's trying to get to an effect. And that's the importance for us.
Okay.
Ditto.
Trying to help out. I'll say for Air Combat Command, we clearly recognize the importance that General Pierce talked about, General Scobee dittoed. In the A3, we realized in my directorate that there are limited developmental opportunities. And across the Air Combat Command, General Holmes has realized that in the SWORD series, from the young enlisted airmen to the majors that are future DOs and commanders to our civilians, our GS-12s and 13s, we've created the SWORD series all the way through. And it brings in our great GS-12s and 13s that have the innovative ideas that have been around a little while but are continuing to develop, and they see a future developmental opportunity that gives them a chance to almost re-blue within the command, but more importantly, share their ideas across the many directorates that they may not see on a daily basis. And we find that really breeds the energy, again, with the big airmen that we're talking about, not only from the total force, but from our civilians directly, to give them the energy and the motivation, because we know that they'll be around and be our continuity for the longest time. And we've also partnered with industry. Industry has offered, in the local area, at least at Langley where we are, to allow a couple of our GS-12s and 13s to come work for 6 months out of the command and be a part of leadership development courses, and then they can bring that innovative ideas back from industry back to the command, and we can just accelerate that that learning even more.
You know, the only, and I couldn't agree more, you guys said that very well. And one thing I will add to it is I love our civilians. That continuity that they bring is incredible. But the other thing is some of our contractors that we have on staff as well do a fantastic job. So I put them in that same category. They are all serving their country in incredible ways. That's true.
And oh, by the way, AFA memberships are certainly open, always open to industry and all our contractors. So next question, General Scobee, for you. Will the future Air Force Reserve full-time force be more comprised of the Air Reserve technicians or AGRs?
That's a great question, Wilbur. So what this is the way we're going forward is when the command chief and I sat down and took a look at where our force is, and we do this with our human capital management team, and that includes General Kelly and the great A1 enterprise we have up at the Pentagon. It's amazing, and then also in San Antonio and for us in Denver. But really what we're looking at is our goal in the Air Force Reserve is to give our airmen the pay statuses that best suits the needs of them and their families. That's what we're trying to do. So what we have found is that the Air Reserve technician, the technician piece, which is part civilian and part military, is somewhat problematic. It works well for some of us, but not everyone. So what we're trying to do is, in our full-time force, about a 50-50 mix of technicians to the AGR pay status. And we're going to look at how, once we get close to 50-50, on how that is allowing us to operate. One of the big changes we're making, and that the Secretary and the Chief are allowing us to do, is we're looking at, we're predominantly about 26% full-time in the reserve, and the rest is part-time. And in that full-time part, we're going to have to bolster that up a little bit in order to make sure we're taking care of all our airmen and the status. But what we really want to make sure is that even though we're about 26% full-time, we want to put the right full-time, part-time ratios in our organizations. And we talk with the MAGCOM commanders about that all the time to make sure we have the statuses that are needed. So if you're if you deploy in garrison for the most part, that AGR pay status really makes a lot of sense for you and your family. If you're in the maintenance career field, we're trying to make a combination of straight civilians, a small percentage that do that, because some folks are just fantastic at that continuity and turning wrenches. We're gonna make some of them AGRs, and we'll make some of them technicians. And that is that is what we're looking at. But right now, what we'll do is, as we get to about 50-50, which will be coming up here very shortly, we'll take a look at it, and then we'll put those right pay statuses in. And sometimes it has to do with things like, what is the cost of living in an area? What are the other opportunities for our airmen? And then what really makes sense for whatever that AFSC or that community is. But we're really looking at changing a lot of those, and Congress has asked us to take a look at that as well. But I'm really excited about the changes that we're making in the Air Force Reserve Command in modernizing what we're doing and trying to give the Air Force everything it needs and airmen in the right pay status that both suits the airmen's and their families' needs, but also suits the MAGCOM commanders and the combatant commanders' needs.
Well, thanks again to everyone for the questions. As we wind up here, last couple minutes, how about starting with General Pierce and then General Huyck, General Scobee? First, favorite memory, this is getting ready to go to the pool, by the way, go to the bar, your first the first memory that, first thing that comes to your mind, favorite memory in the Air Force, in the total force?
I think that's pretty easy for me. I had a unique opportunity to go F-16 guy my entire career, and after being a first assigned instructor pilot, I go to Kingsley. I'm hired by the TAG of Oregon to be the FTU wing commander at Kingsley and fly the F-15. So not only do I get to learn and fly another fighter later in life, which was unique and neat doing that as a wing commander, but in the total force, having the debt two there and have a total force working through about, at the time, 89, now it's getting up closer to 100 members, not students, not that part, but no kidding, maintenance, my dedicated crew chief actively went out and I want an active duty person to be a dedicated crew chief and then assistant dedicated crew chief. And working through that at a place where you're, you know, in a county, there's 42,000 people in a town, a little under 26,000, and having everybody focus on the mission and the total force, it was a really unique opportunity. Loved it. Wish I could have been left alone and kept flying the Eagle there. It would have been nice. But that total force experience was awesome. It really showed what you can do. I mean, there's always policy. There's always some instruction. There's always something that you need to go back to the headquarters and team and try to make changes. Mr. Frederico and SAF MR did great work with us, but that was a unique opportunity, and it really showed how you succeed. And personalities matter. Your dedication as airmen matter. The civilians that are there matter, and that's how we become successful.
Fires me up. General Huyck.
The barbecue clock is counting down here. So my favorite memory was weather canceled from flying a Raptor about 2 weeks ago. Very unfortunate. So I grabbed a bag of jalapeno popcorn and walked around the squadron and the wing there at Langley. And I'll tell you the proudest memory and is walking around, and even though the mission canceled for the day, and you can kind of hear the theme I've been talking about, the intel professionals were working on whatever the next threats were going to be for the next follow-on mission, the follow-on day. The pilots all went to the sims and executed the same mission while they were training. I snuck downstairs, changed into my OCPs, and walked through maintenance and in the supply section. They're innovating new ways to account for tools. The chief was given clear direction to the pro super about the types of things that we're going to need to be worked for the next day. And what it means is the mission continues. We may not be executing right now, but if we're not ready and trained to continue, we'll never get to the things that the combatant commanders and the theater commanders had talked about. So it's just an honor to watch our airmen each and every day.
General Scobee, take us home.
I'll tell you, the greatest thing I ever got to do as a reservist is work in the Pentagon as a programmer under General Holmes. That is not true. The greatest thing about being in this Air Force was I was, as a reservist, I was pulled over to Iraq in 2008 to be an air base commander. I ran Kirk Air Base in 2008. And what was great about that is a total force coming together, 1,200 airmen. It wasn't a flying job. It was running an airbase and seeing what our airmen do every AFSC. There's not one airman out here in this audience or anywhere in our commands that we can do without, because it takes all of us together pulling in the same direction to produce combat power. And I witnessed it firsthand, and I'm here to tell you, I have been everywhere on this earth, and I have met everybody. There is no country in the world like the United States of America and the things that we are able to do to produce and project combat power, and I'm very proud of that aspect. Thanks for your time today.
Thanks, guys.
It.